everybody, this is Caitlin here, and welcome to our next set of spoilers for Force of Will, Echoes of the New World. Last time we were looking at Yggdrasil and the evilness the Lapis has summoned through the use of the regalia of Ataratica, and now we are delving into what seems to be a new character. Kind of weird how we're getting like an onslaught of new characters alongside our old ones after we're just wrapping up this cluster or whatever, but this one's actually kind of interesting because we initially saw her from the teaser trailer, and we also saw her on the pack art and whatnot. So this is the Dragon Shrine Maiden, similar to Ryula and Viola. She seems to be, she's a Dragonoid, it says earlier. She's also a water ruler, so that's where the water attribute. I had a funny feeling she was going to be water when I first saw her. I saw her and I was like, you know what, either her or the last Luminary is going to be like some kind of water ruler, and I was right. She's got a judgment of one blue, so one water, which is fairly cheap, whatever. She also has an energized four blue, so you could literally just use the energized to flip her over if you wanted. You can also tap her to draw a card, which seems like it's too simple on the ruler side, but this is actually a really, really interesting mechanic, and you'll see why when we delve a little bit deeper into these spoilers. At the bottom here it says, this guardian with the power to correct time anomalies had been sealed away by Alhammer. When we flip over, she becomes Flute, or I'm pretty sure that's how you say her name, because it just says Flute. Flute, time-altering priestess. So she seems to be a new kind of Dragonoid priestess or whatever, different to Viola and Ryula anyway. She seems to have a connection or a power with time in particular. She's a 700-800, so not the best stats for a J-ruler we've ever seen, but to be fair, Charlotte also had like not the best stats ever, and she's still like a decent water ruler. So when this card enters your field, put all non-magic stones that were put from a field into your graveyard this turn into your hand. She also releases the seal abilities of water cards and spells you control, which is very, very nice. She also has an added ability that you can pay one water and two void, and you can put this card into your ruler as a ruler. So I do believe that you cannot chase this. So say if you were getting Black Moonbeamed, I believe you could not chase Black Moonbeam with her ability to flip her back over. I believe the only way to save her at this point would be a Windscloud Refuge. So I'm pretty sure that's the case with that, and that it doesn't stop Black Moonbeam, obviously, because you can't chase it other than with Windscloud Refuge, sadly. But it is an interesting ability. So obviously if say like you did like a full board wipe, so say you weren't playing mono blue, you were maybe doing black blue or something like that, and you did like the spell that basically is a board wipe for like I think it's a 5-cost Eternal Recurrence or Eternal Darkness or something like that. You kill everything and then you wait till you do that, and then you have the one blue up or whatever, and you can flip her over, put all that stuff that died into your hand. Also would be really interesting is if you basically killed everything that was maybe on your field. So like you've maybe got a couple of cheap one drops or whatever, you could maybe cast the new Valentina Resonator, where you can pay less for her for each thing that's in your graveyard. So like you can flip her over and then like play this or whatever, or rather you can like kill all your things, then put in Valentina, and then flip, flute over, whatever, to grab those things back from your graveyard. Although you might want to just, like, leave them there, depending on, like, what plays you want to make up. But I think it's really, really interesting. It's a neat mechanic. It's, like, another way of, say, kind of, like, controlling your hand and whatnot. It's really, really interesting, and obviously the seal ability here is very nice for water cards, but we need to see some more water cards, obviously, to see what their seal abilities are. And at the bottom here, if I can just read it here, because sorry, my thing is not in full screen yet, it says, you want me to lend you my power to alter time. So I wonder who she's talking to. We might get like a little indication of who she could possibly be talking to, but we still don't know what side she's on, because she doesn't give any indicator at all about whether she's siding with Lapis, whether she's siding with Gil Alhamat, because it does say that Gil Alhamat sealed her away, so we don't know really why he did that. Like, if like he had the potential to use a Dragonoid that had the power to alter time, why was he not making use of this? Why did he side with Viola instead? Next up, we have Time Altering Magic Stone, our very first glimpse at a special magic stone. We do know that in the set there are two special magic stones, so this is one of them already revealed. At the bottom here, it doesn't actually say its rarity, but considering it's a special magic stone, I would assume it's a rare. It does a simple ability where it taps to produce blue. You can also tap and banish this card, shuffle up to three target non-magic stone cards from their graveyards into their owner's deck. So I'm not quite sure whether there's maybe going to be a way for you to get your stone back into your magic stone deck, because obviously Killing Stone has the ability with Fox, whatever, you do all the different mechanics and everything like that, and you can shuffle the Killing Stone back into the deck. But this doesn't seem to have any mechanism for shuffling it back in, unless there's a card that does that or whatever, and we've not seen it yet. It's a very interesting card. It is a very gorgeous looking art. I would love to see that in full art, because I bet it would be gorgeous. Next up, we have Flute, Water Dragon, a one-cost water resonator. It's 100 attack and 400 defense as a dragon. You may rest this recovered card to call a magic stone rather than rest your J-Wheeler. So a couple of people were asking or whatever, depending how this relates in order with swiftness, with your ruler or whatever. You can still only call one stone per turn, but what this means is that instead of, say, resting Flute for a stone, you can rest the Water Dragon to call your stone, and then you can use Flute's ability when she's on her ruler side to rest her to draw a card instead. So you're still only calling one stone per turn. That's like the way it works, whatever. So instead of like resting Flute, you're resting this to call your stone. But I believe that does not mean you can still Judgment. I think there's a there's like a certain step of things where you can call a stone and Judgment in the same turn or whatever. It's really finicky or whatever, the way you can word it and everything like that. But that's the distinction between them. It also has a seal ability of 5. So once you have 5 or more magic stones, it gets 400, 400 and flying. So once you get 5, which I believe with water would be not quite hard, I think. I think you would be able to get up to 5, but if you did have Flute Flip, then you wouldn't have to really worry too much about the seal ability. So basically this little dragon here can become a 800, if I can do my math correctly, with flying, which isn't that bad, actually. It's a really good, it's kind of like, it's actually out of range of unseen pressure if you manage to break the seal and whatnot, and giving it flying is also a very nice effect to everything like that. It's a very cute card, although its eyes are kind of creeping me out here, and it's a really funny looking dragon and whatnot. But also down at the bottom here, it looks as if Ryola's in the background. Don't know if you can see it there next to the kind of big hulking dragon looking thing. It kind of looks like that's her standing next to it on a rock or whatever. So very interesting to see what else we have here. Next up, we have the Truth of Time, a 1-cost ancient magic chant for just 1 blue or 1 mana if you've got ancient magic. It draws you a card, and if you break the seal on it, which is 6, you draw an extra card. So basically, you're paying 1 or using a mana counter to draw 2 cards, which is net gain in any scenario or whatever, because you're only paying 1. And even though you can just tap Flute in order to draw a card, this is just another way to get 2, which is very, very interesting. I also love the artwork. It's a rare, obviously. It's gorgeous, and oh, the artwork for Flute is just amazing. I love her. She's got a really, really cute design. Next up, we have, honestly, quite a creepy looking card by the card art, but it is another 1-cost chant. It is Flute's Awakening for 1 water. You recover a target J/resonator you control. It cannot attack this turn. Draw a card. So this is actually a good way of, say you're wanting to abuse, I'm trying to think of the right way to say. Say you wanted to, like, you rested, obviously, the dragon or whatever to call a stone. You rested Flute in order to draw a card. You can then use this, because it does say J/resonator, so you could use this on Flute again in order to tap her again to draw a card, I believe. Or if Flute was, say she was rested, whatever, on her J-Ruler side, then you could recover her and potentially block with her again. Obviously, she's better when she's on her ruler side, I feel, because obviously she's still got the ability of tapping to draw a card. But you can also use this for different things, so like if you manage to get a big beefy thing out, you can restore again, basically. It's not attacking again, but it can then block the next turn, which is actually really nice. And at the bottom here it says, having to wake up all on her own was her worst nightmare. I wonder what this means, because Lapis here seems to be like, I'm not quite sure what he's up to here. He seems to be delving into her mind or activating the strange symbol on her forehead or whatever. And also it says, having to wake up all on her own was her worst nightmare. So maybe she's been asleep all this time while she's been sealed away by Alhamat. Lapis has maybe broken her out, because obviously Viola sided with Alhamat, Viola sided with Milliam. I guess he thought, I need a Dragonoid on my side. But it seems strange how there's so many people allying with Lapis at this point. It's just like, you know, is he actually going to win in the end? I'm not too sure. Next up, we have Luna, Magician of the Moonstar, a 3-cost resonator. She is 2 water and 1 void, 800, 800, 7 Luminaries Mage. She has Will of Despair and mana 4, so she comes in with 4 mana counters on her. You can remove a mana counter from this card and produce water. You can spend this will only to play ancient magic cards, so that would actually be very good for some of the ancient magic we saw earlier on. She also has the quote down at the bottom that says, Lord Alhamat is dead, and no matter what side I choose now, I can't win. Oh well. So this does confirm that by this point, Alhamat is dead. Not quite sure who has killed him. I believe someone was saying maybe the controlled power of the Millennium Dragon with Lapis, possibly, killed him. And now Lapis is just, you know, betraying everyone, being like, right now, my dad is dead. I can actually fight everyone else. It seems that Luna is kind of a little bit late to the party, so she shows up after Alhamit dies. So I'm guessing she just doesn't know what side to pick now, because obviously the world is pretty much doomed either way, it seems. Like, she doesn't want to pick the good guy's side or whatever, because obviously that would feel like betraying Altia. She doesn't want to pick Lapis, because obviously he's a traitor to Altia as well. And, you know, she doesn't really have many options here now that, like, I'm guessing all the other luminaries are dead, or essentially, because I think the only one who is still alive was Sol, other than Luna. So I'm guessing Sol is also dead and that she's the last one, which is kind of a little bit depressing, and I feel a little bit sorry for her, but I wonder if she will eventually pick a side and whether that might help turn the tide of the battle. And then last but not least, we have the Blue Planet. It is a 2-cost addition, 1 water and 1 void. When this card enters your field, you draw a card, which, you know, pretty decent for blue. It has a seal ability of 7, but obviously if float is flipped over, it's kind of hard saying float flipped over, it's like a tongue twister or whatnot. But if she is flipped, then the seal of 7 is released and cards in your hand gain quick cast, which is absolutely insane. Can you imagine that? So basically it's a seal of 7. You just need float flipped in order to like have that. I don't know if there'll be going to be another blue resonate or something like that that releases seal abilities. I doubt that it will, because obviously we've already got it on the blue ruler. But can you imagine all your things with quick cast? Like, so resonators with quick cast, all these different chants and whatnot that are quick cast that weren't already. So bear transformation magic is already quick cast. But can you imagine, like, say, additions, like, so say the fairy extract, if that could become quick cast, that would be amazing. I don't know if additions could become quick cast, but it just says cards in your hand, so it doesn't specifically say resonators and spells, so I guess it just means anything. So anything's fair game, I guess. Resonators, all that kind of good stuff, bouncing things, stealing things, heck, Valentina the Puppet Monarch, you can stick it in your field that turn and steal whatever's attacking you. That would be a pretty good shout, pretty good shout. Also, the card art is absolutely gorgeous in this. It's no word of a lie, it's actually gorgeous. So those are these spoilers for today, guys. Let me know down below what you think of these spoilers. Personally, I feel like I might build a deck for Flute. I'm not quite sure what kind of colours I'll build yet. I feel like I don't want to make it mono blue, because I feel like maybe mono blue would be a bit too much, like, not enough kind of, like, support and whatnot. It's hard to build a mono blue deck and not have anything else to back it up or whatever, because, you know, blue is, I think, one of the weaker colors out of all the colors we have in Force of Will. Wind is pretty strong still, but I feel like I would maybe make it a dual color deck. Not sure what colors I would use to support it. Maybe light, possibly black, I'm not too sure yet, but I definitely want to build for Fluke. She seems really cute. I love her. She might be my new dragon waifu, even though it's just like Sylvia's still the top of my heart, but Fluke might be a close second there. So anyway, guys, I hope you enjoyed these spoilers. Leave a comment down below. What do you think of these? Do you have a favorite card so far? Who's your favorite ruler so far? And what do you think finally caused Alhamit to die? Who do you think defeated him in battle? So until next time, guys, I will see you all later.